Oh yeah, mi gente, you know who this is. I want to do a just very brief review on a wonderful film that I have been watching over and over again. I just love this film. The name of this film is called Home, and it stars and is executive produced by Banga Akinagbe. I believe I'm saying his name right. And you probably know him from a lot of roles on different movies and television and things like that. But basically, he's portraying a black man living in New York City who is living with a very serious persistent mental illness. At no point in the movie did they specifically say it was schizophrenia. However, living with that myself and just seeing a lot of the things that happen in the film, it seems pretty clear that that was his illness that he was living with. The film opens up and he's being pursued by some of the staff from the group home that he lives in. And they're chasing him through a store and through the street, but actually comes to find out he's having a night terror or nightmare. So he wakes up out of the dream, and then you get to see the different people there in the group home where he lives. What separates Jack, his character, from the other people there, the majority of them, that he has an actual drive and determination to actually leave the group home. Because a lot of people, you know, when they get in situations like that, for a myriad of reasons, wind up not leaving unfortunately. And everyone's circumstance is their own, you know, what they go through and what happens in different circumstances. And then some people leave by other means, you know. But his thing, he had a drive to actually get out and get his life back on track. And there are a very colorful cast of characters that are there in the group home. And in terms of the actual other residents, there are a couple people there that he's cool with, but he's, you know, like slightly at odds with the staff. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in a second with this review. But so we go to him and he's in his room and he's, you know, making plans. And then at a later portion in the film, he's going back over his, medical records and history, psychiatric history. And he pulls up his papers and it's revealed that he was diagnosed with this mental illness that they did not specify at the age of 18. And it also revealed that he was extremely intelligent. He tutored, math students in his sophomore year of high school. And he was above average in some of his studies. He was very intelligent. He played softball or baseball in school. He just, you know, he had it really going on. But for a lot of people, you know, around the age, especially for men with mental illness, generally strikes around that age, you know, in the younger years, around your late teenage years, things like that or whatever. And he just began to really, really decompensate. And then we switch back to when he is having to go before the new psychiatrist. And in the film, they've had like three different psychiatrists. One died. The psychiatrist that was over the group home. One died. One got another job. He got the hell out of there, whatever, right? And then there's this new guy that nobody particularly likes. And he comes across as kind of arrogant, distant, disconnected. And he doesn't appear to have much of an expectation for the clients. And that's sad. And so many times, that is some of the vibe that you'll get, you know, from some psychiatric doctors and some psychiatric staff at some of these places. A low expectation. Some of them expect for you to succeed or expect you to go far or ever leave or accomplish anything. And so they project that. So it sets you up almost, if you digest that, for failure. And so this is very evident in the way that he deals with Jack. The nurse there, however, she's a bit more empathetic and encouraging, but of course she can't cross the line too far because that psych doc is her boss or whatever, right? So, as I told you, Jack, wanted to definitely rebuild his life. He wants to move out. He wants to get back to who he was, have his own place and all that. One of the reasons for that, a primary reason for that, is because he has a son, 12 years old, named John. And John is a product of his relationship with his ex-girlfriend, who he was with for a long time. She stated in the movie they had known each other forever. And then they showed some of the things that happened that broke them apart and that got John, you know, institutionalized. And he was having psychotic episodes, and the police had to be called. And then they show the scene where he's at the hospital, he's handcuffed, and he's highly psychotic and highly agitated and all of this. And so we go forward, you know, years later, and now he's in the group home, he's on medication, and he's much more stable. He still has, you know, some deficits from, you know, his cognitive symptoms, which I believe are as a result of schizophrenia, because I recognize them myself, and I recognize them in him during this movie. I also want to point out that because of all of the episodes that he's had in the past, his baby's mother doesn't allow him to take his son John out unsupervised. Her new boyfriend actually escorts them every place they go when John gets to visit his son, which is once a month. And the relationship between John and his baby's mother's new boyfriend or husband is very amicable. It's warm, it's friendly, but appropriate. And one thing I will notice is that Jack didn't have a lot of support. It was like very minimal support, and that's something that in real life a lot of people with psychiatric disabilities, particularly with schizophrenia, find themselves not having a lot of support. A lot of times that support becomes strained and alienated when they begin to have, you know, if behaviors or psychotic episodes occur, and then people sometimes just cannot handle it, don't want to be bothered, and then you just begin to, you know, lose friends. They drop off like dead flies or whatever. I could certainly attest to that, and that's painful and it's difficult. And so in many instances you're left with what minimal support you can get from staff if you're in an institution or a group home, whatever, and then whatever support you can gather from your, you know, fellow residents at the group home. However, that sometimes can be minimal as well, because a lot of them may be very, very ill or very, very medicated, and so to even try to get a substantive conversation is like pulling horse teeth or something like that, you know. So he definitely, there was a lot of loneliness. But what I really admired about Jack is that he had drive, and that drive in him remained intact. Because a lot of times in schizophrenia, one of the negative features that you can get is avolition. It's when you have the lack of drive, when you have no desire. It takes your desire, like, flattens you out, and you have no drive or energy to really do and achieve and aspire and grow, you know, like you did before, possibly. So, moving on with this story, you'll see, as I told you, that he can't go unsupervised. So, you'll see right there that his John's stepfather is with them every place they go, as I mentioned. Also, John, or Jack rather, had a plan to move out, and he found this one particular apartment, but then he found another situation, and he liked it better. He found it himself, talked to the supervisor at the place or whatever, but then come to find out they changed the terms of the rent, and they wanted an astronomical amount that he didn't have. So he did everything he could, even went back to his father to ask him for help, and his father was cold, his ice turned him down flat, and his father, you know, when Jack asked him for help, told him no. And he told him that he wasn't realistic and he wasn't going to help him. And they talked about the relationship that his father did not have with his mother and how he pretty much did her the same way. And it was just terrible. I mean, no support even from family. That was his own father, but he acted like he was a stranger in the street to his own son. A lot of times you see that in families, like I said, with people with mental illness. The people just don't want to be bothered. And then sometimes if people are just an asshole, they're an asshole regardless. But this just made it all the worse. So Jack went back to his job that he had as a messenger, trying to get more runs and things like that. But that wasn't working. And so out of desperation, he went to try to go stay with the one good friend that he did have, who lived outside of the group home, named Dundee, who also was living with a mental illness. His situation or condition wasn't described, but at any rate, he went to look for him at the place he told him that he lived, and it wasn't what he said. He actually lived at a place more like a shelter type of situation with just beds or whatever, and so he was tragically disappointed because it was getting close to the time that he had established that he wanted to move out of the group home, and he has nowhere to go. So, out of desperation, Jack turns to the street, and he used to, you know, be involved with street drugs and drinking and stuff like that in his younger days when he was ill, and the guy that he ran drugs for, on occasion, he went to go see him, and he wound up reluctantly giving Jack a run. Jack had to go up into Washington Heights, right, in Manhattan, and that was a disaster. He was followed on the way to where he was going to make his drop off, and he got followed on the way back out. He got paranoid and he hid, and he fell asleep where he hid under this porch, and he was there for 12 hours. When he got back to the guy to drop off the money, the guy was pissed off. He didn't give him any money. Jack asked for his money, and then the guy, basically him and two other guys beat Jack down. I'm very glad they didn't really show that on the camera, and it wasn't an extenuated long scene. They didn't hurt him really bad, so that was tolerable to see, but it was sad. Finally, Jack wound up getting a call from the guy that he initially wanted to rent from, and something had transpired where he'd be able to go and see about another apartment. And he got over there, and the lady interviewed him, and she asked him, you know, how he was, and she had heard from the guy that referred him he had some trouble in the past, I guess in regards to his mental illness, mental disability. He said he was better and that things would be better for him and he wouldn't be any problem there, and she gave him the place. And consequently, his son John and his baby's mother came by, and she actually let him stay inside and visit with his son. And that's how the movie concluded, you know. And this is just a wonderful film, and Benga, I hope I'm saying his name right, he really nailed this part, you know. He really gave the clear illustration, and schizophrenia can manifest itself in different ways, but I mean, it was kind of like, in a way, seeing myself maybe just a notch or two lower in functioning. But I mean, it was just wonderful. This is a wonderful, wonderful film, and he made it so realistic for a lot of people that are living with this particular mental health diagnosis. So I just want to recommend this film, and I want to say this will be a little bit of just I guess a combination vent, because I don't feel like making two videos. Well, let me say this actually before I say that. What I loved about it was that he was so utterly convincing. The only thing that I will say is that I wish that they could have showed a little bit more of his symptoms that was kind of muted, and a little bit more of his emotional responses, but that could have actually been accurate. The not showing much of the symptoms and not showing much of his emotional reactions to a lot of things that happened, because of one or two things. In schizophrenia, you have a thing called flattening, you know, And that takes away a lot of your expression. You may be feeling all emotion in the world, but you just may not be able to demonstrate it on your face, you know, in a succinct manner. And also the medication can do that. And the medication can take away your emotional responses. That happens often. And also, in terms of the symptoms, you would get like a little glimpse of something, and then it would just go away. That could have been the medication, and they could have been demonstrating how the medication was muting his symptoms. But I guess if he were sufficiently medicated, and if that's the way for him, and as I've told you over and over in many of my videos, not everyone can tolerate the medication. I'm one of those people. So I have these alternative, you know, healthy, natural, organic methods, also including, you know, one-on-one therapy, group therapy, things like that, you know, being physically active, listening to music to help myself, you know, or whatever. But, you know, overall, this was a wonderful film. I could see his frustrations, and a lot of times I get frustrated as well. More of my symptoms are more on the cognitive, you know, level, getting embarrassed, almost walking in the wrong bathroom, the other down at McDonald's, and I'm trying to throw my garbage away. I wound up putting the tray in the garbage and putting my garbage that was in the bag on top of the, basically I reversed what I was doing. Or sometimes getting confused with the traffic lights changing. It's terrible and it's embarrassing, and then getting anxious, you know, sometimes when I'm out on the bus or whatever. So it kind of appears probably to people I'm in a conversation with myself, but I'm trying to sort things out, because sometimes when I'm out amongst a lot of people, it's overstimulating, you know, it's kind of overwhelming. So I'm trying to, you know, figure things out as best I can, or just getting really extremely forgetful, or being sometimes over anxious. Like today, I've been up for hours, but I'm trying to get myself to go outside. I don't know if it's going to happen today. I'm going to really try. You know, just sometimes get really tired, and I can see the same frustrations in different ways in Jack's character in this film. So overall, I mean, he made it really relatable. He definitely nailed this. I would highly recommend this film. Out of 10 stars, I give it 9.5, and that's creeping up on a 10, really. I've watched it several times in the last few days. So get into this movie, rent this movie, purchase this movie, support this movie. Tell people about this movie, you know, if you want to know more about schizophrenia. I think it's a really great film, and I'm really proud of him as a black man getting out there and showing this. And there's another great film about a mental illness, dissociative disorder, formerly known as multiple personality disorder, that Halle Berry's in, called Frankie and Alice. I plan to see that as soon as possible. But do that and support people with mental illnesses. You know, we need your support. All right, much love. Te quiero.